everyone, and welcome to Marketing and Sales Over Cocktails, the weekly podcast that helps you grow your business, improve your life, and enjoy yourself along the way. I'm your host, Alan Langer, and every week we try to bring you the best thought leaders, the best business leaders, and the best minds out there to help you succeed in business and in life. So sit back, relax, grab your pad, your pen, and your favorite beverage, and enjoy the next episode of Marketing and Sales Over Cocktails. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Marketing and Sales Over Cocktails. I'm your host, Alan Langer. And once again, I don't know how this is happening, but I have another great guest. I have one great guest after another. This is episode 21, I believe. I believe it's 21. I'm losing count, but I say that every week, but I should really check what number of episodes these are when I do them. But we have AmyK tonight. Okay, AmyK Hutchens she's a lot of things. She's a best-selling author. She's an international speaker. And she's going to come on in just a second because I'm really excited to talk to AmyK. We just had Jill Conrath on, and now Amy's backing that up. But before we get to Amy, a couple of housekeeping items. I just want to remind everyone, the website is marketingandsalespodcast.com. And don't forget the Ask Alan segment of the podcast. If you send me a question and we use your question on the air, you will get a free autographed signed copy of my book. And we've got a great question coming up from Hillary way out from Seattle, Washington tonight. So we'll get to that question at the end of the podcast. But just go to the website, marketingandsalespodcast.com. Go to the contact section and send me the question, and we can go from there. So, without further delay, AmyK Hutchens, welcome to the podcast. How are you doing tonight?
I'm awesome. Thanks for letting me have a cocktail in your sandbox, Alan.
Yes. So, you're awesome because a few guests couldn't do this at night, so we were having marketing and sales over coffee recently. So, I'm very excited to have cocktails. So, what are you enjoying this evening?
Oh, I was just going to say cheers. I'm doing a classic G&T.
G&T. I was going to show this to the audience. So I have an Irish whiskey, but here's what's special about it. So I'm going to hold this up to the camera so the audience can see it. It's called Writer's Tears. And Amy and I, both being published authors, love this because when you write a book, you experience a lot of tears.
You sure do. But I'm going to do a quick sip. Cheers to you and congratulations cheers. Too for being a writer.
Thank you. So cheers to you. Virtual cheers. Thanks for coming on the podcast. So real quick, I like the guests to talk about themselves, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about Amy. So she's got a best-selling book. It's brand new, right? When did this one come out, the Get It book?
Spring of 2020. Yeah, just last May.
So just last May, this book came out. It's called Get It. And it's, I love the subtitle, 5 Steps to the Sex, Salary, and Successes You Want. Tell me a little bit about that book, and then we could talk about how you got into everything and how, you know, cool you are and all that stuff. So tell me a little bit about that book.
Yeah, I do a lot of professional speaking, coaching, and consulting. And one of the things that I noticed that was happening in my coaching sessions is that it was always coming down to communication. And I travel around the world talking about communication, but even in the sales and in the personal life of marriage, it just seemed like everything was coming back to, can you help me navigate this tough conversation? And so that's what the book is all about. When we started getting huge wins, like closing multi-million dollar deals or saving a marriage. I'm not a therapist, Alan. I'm not a family counselor, but it's like, this stuff works. So yeah. In the book, it's about really how to take a tough conversation and turn it into a profitable one, which gets me stoked just that it's helping so many people.
Well, that's what I loved about when I saw your stuff, because, you know, we talk about sales, we talk about marketing, we talk about a lot of different things on this podcast. It's not just about that, but I really love the conversational piece about this because everything, you even write, life happens one conversation at a time. That's right on your website. And the power of profitable conversations. You can't be successful if you don't know how to have a good conversation. And that's kind of what you've been focusing on, right?
It's true. I think that whether you're, you know, a brilliant architect or a brilliant doctor, the way that you become really successful is through this foundational skill of communication. And I don't say it like I woke up one day and I was like this magical communicator. In fact, it was the opposite, Alan. I would say things that I would regret. You know, I'd be like, Could I just take my words back? But over time, you know, you get better at it. And then one of the things, I had like a seminal moment early in my career when I realized that the life that I wanted and the life that my clients wanted, it was on the other side of a tough conversation. And then that really just sort of galvanized me. And I became obsessed about helping everybody that I know become better at communication skills.
And was this, did you do research on it, or was it just experience over the years, or talk to specific people? How did you become such a known person for doing this and knowing really what you're talking about?
It's both. It's from my own personal experiences, good and bad. Right. It's also from all the research that I did. So I come with a grad degree from Hopkins in neuroscience and in the brain and how we learn and how we function. And then I've got the classic, you know, 19 years of being an entrepreneur. I had some very serious and high level corporate positions in my career. And so it was just really realizing that at the end of the day, we were all given a voice box and it never came with instructions.
Exactly right. Well, for the people who are viewing this podcast, because it's both audio and video, you can tell AmyK came from the corporate world because she's in a beautiful suit and I'm in a Mickey Mouse t-shirt. So I did not come from the corporate world. I was in-home sales for many, many years. So, but this is one of my favorite t-shirts. So I decided to wear it for you tonight. So,
well, and I'm so happy for you, Alan, that you never had to experience that. I'm so happy for you.
I experienced the corporate side from the sales end, like what the corporation was doing to the sales teams, but yes. I was never in the leading the boardrooms and stuff like that. Cause I don't think I'd be able to do that. So kudos to you for getting through that and getting out of it. So let's talk about there's quite a few things we chatted about when we were getting ready for this podcast. And one of the things you talk about, power versus connection in conversation. What does that mean exactly? Because that really resonates with me.
Well, I believe that every single time we come with an intention, and it's either to connect with somebody, meaning I want to hear you and I want to better understand you, or I want to be heard and I want to be better understood. And so that's really coming from a place of, I'm open to hearing your story. I'm open to better understanding your background, your experiences to explain where we're at today. Power from within means that I might have to put a boundary in place, or I might have to honor the worth of my own voice. Now, power over is to me a negative thing. That's like domination, manipulation. I'm here to hurt. I'm here to wound. But power from within says that I'm going to speak up for myself. So in sales, one of the things that I always talk about in sales training is you can either show up and you can connect or you can pitch. And you will close the deal a lot faster if the very first conversation that you have is a connect. And so I always joke, I fly a lot. I live on the road. Well, pre-pandemic, I lived on the road. And so I always talk about, I was on this flight one time and I just, you know, I'm not a big talker on a flight. I'm really an introvert, but I'm not rude. I wasn't raised by wolves. So I just asked this guy, are you flying for business or pleasure? And he was like, business. And I was like, well, what do you do? And Alan, I kid you not, he says, well, I merge and integrate systems. And I was like, okay, well, tell me a little bit more about that. And he was like, yeah, I merge and integrate systems. And I was like, dude, I am not going to talk your ear off for the next 7 hours. But there was no connection. And so right. I was like, can you just give me an example? And he was like, well, you know, do you have computers that talk to each other? And I was like, yeah, but you know, I'm not dumb, dude. Like, talk to me, right? And so he was really funny. He was like, well, that's what I do. I made the mistake, Alan, of looking at this guy and saying, oh, you're like my IT guy.
Oh, no.
Mister, I own a fleet of sports cars and drive the Autobahn. I was like, I am not your IT guy. But he made it so hard to connect with them. And then the flip fun side of that is that a couple of years later, I was at a networking event after a conference and I did the same thing. I was like, hey, what do you do for a living? And this guy says, AmyK, picture a fire truck. And I was like, okay. And he says, take that fire truck and flip it upside down. And I was like, okay. He says, everything that fell off, we make. And I was like, oh my God.
Oh my God. That's awesome. That's so awesome.
Isn't that awesome? That is so awesome. And he's sitting there trying to connect with me. And I think, Alan, what makes the story so disparately different is that when that guy says, what did you picture falling off the fire truck? And I'm like, helmets and axe handles and hoses. He's like, that's what we make. The guy turns out to be a PhD in polymer science, but he didn't lead with that. He led with connection, not pitch. And that's to me like the fundamental thing that we all have to do is when we show up to a conversation, you either choose connection or power from within, depending on what you want.
You know, you're resonating so much because once a month I put out on LinkedIn that I open up 10 slots on my calendar for anybody that wants to talk to me for free. I love doing it. I get to meet a lot of people. So obviously we start the conversation. I say, okay, tell me what you do. And I do this on purpose. And I have a little stopwatch and I start it. And I clock how long it takes them to tell me what they do. And some of them are like just like that in 15, 30 seconds. Perfect. I had someone on the Zoom the other day, and I had to stop her after about 7 minutes, and I said stop. I was up to 7 minutes. I said, first of all, we only have 30 minutes on the call, and I said, I still don't know what you do. She's like, what? I said, you've been talking for 7.5 minutes. I showed her the stopwatch. I still don't know what you do. I said, I want you to do this exercise. Pretend you're at a family picnic, and your 8-year-old niece comes up to you and says, Aunt Mary, tell me what you do. You have to explain to your 8-year-old niece what you do in her attention span, which is going to be less than a minute. How would you do it? And like that, she thought about it, and then she was able to figure it out. And right away, it was like, oh, that's what you do. I connected with you. So many people get caught up in all the minutia of the technical details and the not connection. It's just, that really is a powerful thing that you're talking about.
Well, that's a brilliant exercise. I mean, that I love that. The geek in me loves that, because Einstein said, if you can't explain what you do to a kindergartner, you don't know it well enough.
Yeah, exactly.
I love that.
It really is such a simple thing to do. I mean, I talk to so many technical people, and the majority of them, 9 out of 10, have trouble explaining what they know what they do inherently. They just can't tell people what they do. They don't understand how to tell it properly. So I started doing that, and some people really struggle with it for a while. I'm like, do the exercise, spend a few days and come back with it. And because they don't know how to, like, one guy said, well, why would I even explain this to an 8-year-old? Because she's your niece and she wants to know what you do.
Come on, dude. And then you're like, technical foul, you're missing the point.
Completely missing the point. So that is awesome. I love that. So. And I love the imagery of flipping the fire truck over, flipping it upside down. That's awesome.
Well, and that was years ago, and I've never forgotten it, which just shows you that, like, if you can explain what you do, as you're saying, to your 8-year-old niece or nephew, then what you're saying is, I'm going to make it really sticky and really easy, and I'm going to be far more approachable. I mean, you know, I've referred that guy business. Mr. Fire Truck, I've sent him business. The merger integrator IT guy, I've never seen him, never talked about him except to tell the story.
Right. And you're glad you met him, because you met him because you needed that story to tell.
I did. I needed the counter story.
All right. Since we're talking about sales, one of the things that you mentioned was there's a conversation that most salespeople are not having. Tell me what you mean by that.
So this is a great segue from the connection piece. So one of the things that I think that a lot of salespeople show up to a sales conversation is to either continue to, I'm going to talk about my product, I'm going to talk about how it solves your problem, but they're not going to build a psychological connection with either their prospect or their existing customer. And so I really believe that there are 6 questions that, when used in order, always in order, you can have one of the most effective sales conversations you're ever going to have in your entire career. And it starts by showing up with strengths, talking about what's working, talking about either what you both want in the partnership, or if it's a prospect, what the person that you're talking to wants, what's the benefit when they get what they want, what are some of their concerns that are going to prevent them from getting what they want, and then you're going to talk about tweaks. And so, for instance, Alan, I'll role play, because this is really straightforward and it's profoundly effective. So if I show up, and let's just say you and I've been doing business for 18 months already, and I want to continue the relationship, then I would show up and I'd say, hey, Alan, can I just have like 7 minutes of your time? I just want to touch base. And you're like, sure. You know, AmyK, we've been working for a while. Mm-hmm. So then I say, Alan, from your perspective, what do you see as the strengths of our partnership? What's working in our partnership? Where are you going in the next 6, 9, 18, 36 months? What's the benefit to you, your employees, the community, the industry, your charity, your causes when you meet and exceed your objectives? What are some of your concerns? And it's not that cheesy, what keeps you up at night. It's like, what are your concerns that could prevent you from being successful? Mm-hmm. And then last but not least, you come back to yourself and you say, well, then either here's what I'm going to do more of, better, in addition to add value to our partnership, or here's some things, and what are some of your ideas for how I can add more value? So that's with an existing relationship. In terms of a prospect, like Alan, if I've never done business with you, it's the same formula, but with some subtle tweaks. So I would say, what are the strengths of your company or your organization? What's working for you? Where do you want to go in the next 6, 9, 18, 36 months? What's the benefit to you, your company, your people, your charities, causes, community, industry? What are some of your concerns? And then I'd say, well, let me tell you a little bit about myself, because I think I could really add value to ensure you meet and exceed your objectives. Here's some tweaks that I could help you make. It is a fantastic framework so that your client feels heard, understood, and like they have an ally that's all focused on them.
That is amazing. You know, I always talk about when I do some training, there's two questions. People always ask, what questions do I need to ask? And those are brilliant. I love that sequence of that, because it puts you in that framework that you listen to the client, which is the biggest complaint, I think, for most prospects is the salesperson didn't listen to me. They had their own agenda. So the questions I ask are very similar. It's like, ask, where do you see yourself in 12 or 18 months from now? Just tell me that. And then I say, where are you now? Where do you see yourself now? What's happening now? And they're going to tell you that's the concerns. Like, this is what we're struggling with, but I want to get to here. But I like what you did there, because there's extra depth in those questions. So that's pretty cool stuff. I'm going to obviously write those down when I rewatch this.
Well, I love you and I are doing the same sort of framework of where are we now, right? And then where do we want to be so that we can close that gap? I just sort of feel like sometimes in very short conversations in a 90-mile-an-hour world, the thing that I want to be ensuring is that I avoid somebody dumping all of their frustrations on me, and then Alan follows in behind me and does all the exciting, you know, future conversation. So if I don't, and this is why I love yours, where do you want to be? I love that you ask that first. Yep. Because you're helping them to paint that positive picture first. Just like strengths and what's working, it's positive before we go, okay, let's talk about the things that are really causing you an ulcer.
Yeah, you can't, and you can't tell someone what their pain, I don't like to use the word pain, but you have to let them explain it to you. I see so many reps saying, you know, these are your problems and these is how I can fix them. Well, you don't know if that's their problems. It's the same thing with selling a copy machine and talking about 75 features and all the guy cares about is stapling. You know what I mean? You got to find what are they concerned about? That's what you got to find out.
You know, one of the things that I love about that, it reminds me of a magical phrase. So I'm a huge curator of magical phrases. I love magical phrases.
All right, give me a few.
I'm not a fan of scripting. So say it again.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I want to hear your magical phrases. I wrote that down. So I was going to ask you that anyway. So let's get to it.
No, this is good. This is just, it's like a natural segue. So one of the things that I was just riffing off of you saying that you've got to ask them. And one of the things that I love is when you ask a repercussion question. So a repercussion question is that person telling you whether something is good or bad versus you making a false assumption. So it's possible that I could say to you like, well, you know, clearly we got to help you, you know, reach that goal. And you're like, no, I don't want to reach that goal. And then I have to pay like extra kind of fines and fees for blah. And you're like, oh, I made the false assumption. So when you ask a repercussion question, you let the person that you're talking to lead you to the either their own challenge that you can solve or their own outcome that they're excited about. Either way, they're the ones that are actually selling themselves on you. So I'll say something like, well, what happens, Alan, when you've got three fun, energetic podcast guests in a row? You know, and then you tell me what happens when that outcome occurs. Or I can do the inverse. I could say, oh, Alan, what happens when you have three duds in a row? But just by saying what happens when, I turn it over to you.
Absolutely. But in both situations, which is great. You're telling me what's great about that. And also, yeah, this is what happens when I screw up the guests that I have, which I haven't done yet. So you're evidence of that right now.
No, it's all good. But it's kind of like if I work in a family business, if one of my clients is a family business, and they'll say something like, oh, my brother Pete runs sales. I don't want to assume that Pete's a rock star or a nincompoop. So I'll just say, well, what happens, you know, when Pete's running sales? And they'll be like, oh my God, he's like totally got it under control. Okay, good, right? Not a false assumption on my part that I've now like insulted your brother. or they say of their own accord, oh, pizza fiasco. And you're like, oh, okay, note to self, right? But yeah. I didn't make a false assumption that bit me in the butt.
Yes, absolutely. I've been doing a little consulting work with this company that's, I would say, a little behind the times from a technical standpoint. And there was
fax that to you?
Yeah. Well, here, one of the things was I sent them a proposal. They accepted the proposal. I said, okay, at the bottom, there's a little link. Click on that and you can pay online. And she said, we don't have a company credit card. Where can I mail the check? And I'm like, a check? Like, you actually going to print a check? I haven't gotten a check. And I don't know when the last time I got a check. So stuff like that. But the bad thing was I asked, okay, how many of your sales reps are on LinkedIn? And they said none. I'm like, oh.
Ouch.
Yeah. So I got a lot of work to do. But I just let them tell me all that because that was rife with, I could have made a lot of false assumptions, either good or bad. So you just got to, you got to let them tell you.
Yeah. I mean, look at the opportunity. And I say this sincerely, you know, my first reaction is ouch. And then my thoughtful response is actually, that's incredibly exciting because you can do so much good for them.
Oh, I'm so excited about it. I'm like, they're going to be blown away. And, you know, it's just, I just kind of like that they reached out and they said, we need help, but they really didn't know how much help that they needed. But once we had our onboarding conversation, they were like, wow, we really need some help. So it's going to be fun. But so tell me, you like magical phrases. Give me another one of your favorites.
You know, one of the things that I think is a really good one right now, especially in sales and everything with all these turbulent and emerging times that we're going through. Another one is that won't do, but it's not a defensive play. So I have to put it in context. This is about aligning yourself with either a teammate or a colleague from another department or one of your customers. So we just did a huge customer service training earlier this year. And this was one of the most popular and favorite phrases of the customer service team. So like, for instance, if you come to me and you say, you know, my shipping is behind schedule. I was supposed to have it yesterday and I still don't have it. When a customer service rep says, oh, Alan, that won't do. Let's find out what's going on with your shipping. I didn't get defensive. I didn't make you feel bad. I didn't say that we were taking responsibility or that we're doing a blame game. What I said was, I'm going to actually take responsibility for helping you solve the problem, not necessarily for the error yet. Now, you might end up having an apology that you owe somebody if there's an internal error. But right. What I love about it is that you don't get defensive. You don't react. You lean into somebody and say, oh, that won't do. And that is a fabulous way to take the wind out of somebody's sails right now.
I love that. And it makes them feel like you're on their side. You're going to help them without throwing anyone else in the company under the bus. It's like, oh, no, that's I like that. I just wrote that down.
It's strong. Another one of my magical phrases that I've been using a lot right now to close just a little bit faster is to say something on the lines of, hey, Alan, do you believe that this is going to have a positive impact? Do you believe that this is a solution that will work for you? Like any kind of just natural, authentic riff off of, do you believe that? And mm-hmm. It's either a solution or will create a positive impact because you want that person to have that neurological mini yes in their head. I call it a mini must win. So the minute that you say yes of your own accord, I am one step closer to calling you a customer.
Yeah, absolutely. So what do you, when you say, you know, these are the conversation, the closing that you're doing now, what are your sales? Are you selling yourself as far as sales training or speaking? What do you actually, or tell me what you're doing as far as when you're in front of a potential client?
So I speak right now, all virtual keynotes just because of the pandemic. And then I do a lot of coaching, consulting, and then we have an online program. So people are talking to me. So like just yesterday, I was talking with a huge technology and aviation company, and they're like, okay, we're interested in doing your online program. So we're talking about the value that it would create. We're talking about it being at a fraction of a price. So here's something to think about in sales too when you're having this conversation. One of the most classic objections that we hear is, your price is too high. And when I say you, I'm talking about the ubiquitous you. You know, there's always somebody that like wants to be in your sandbox, like, Alan, you're amazing, but I can't afford you. Or AmyK, I really want to work with you, but you're too expensive. And so what we tend to do is a knee-jerk reaction of lowering our price, or we start to talk about price. And instead, in that conversation, one of the most beautiful and brilliant ways to shift the conversation is to say, Say more about being too high. What do you mean by that? Or too high as compared to what? Give me a little bit more context about what you're comparing us to, or the thought inside your head. Or I'll say, what's the thought behind the comment too high? But I want to get more information from them before I start to get into defensive or value creation mode. I want to turn the conversation back on them.
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree. I agree 1,000% because I write in my book that there's such an aversion to salespeople and the sales pitch to begin with, that we have this built-in defense mechanism that we're not born with it. It's learned as we get older because we talk to so many bad salespeople, that we have this knee-jerk reaction that says, without even thinking, all right, let me think about it. Or, or yeah, your price is too high, let me think about it. Like, we don't even know why we're saying it sometimes. And it's just the anxiety of buying and you're not feeling comfortable. So that's a good way of actually having them, you know, flesh that out a little bit.
Well, and if they get pushy, you know, just to add another layer to that, then I'll often say, well, let me share with you the thought process behind our pricing. Because it's very possible that you haven't created enough value in their mind, or you really are a higher tier. Like comparatively, you are, I always joke, like, let's just do the easy. Are you Bergdorf Goodman? Are you Nordstrom? Are you Walmart? Right? So understanding where you are and making sure that they're comparing apples to apples and not apples to oranges.
Right. Exactly. Wow. This is great stuff. We are almost at 40.
I love what I do.
I can't tell. You look really bored. We're actually going to continue this conversation after the podcast, but we'll get to that in a minute. So I wanted to ask you a question real quick about, and the reason I'm asking this is because it's come up a couple times this week, is I get a lot of reps saying, since we're on questions, do I have a survey? Like, do I have a sheet that I ask the questions and fill it out in front of the customer? How do I handle writing down the questions and things like that? So I've always hated, and when I was with companies, they would train you to like take your pad and fill out the survey like you're in a doctor's office, which I always hate. I never did it. But there's the companies still train that. You got to ask all of these 15 questions to the customer, no matter what. And I have a different take on that, but I want to hear what you think.
Well, my first response is I think it depends on context. So for instance, if you're in a section of the sales cycle or the sales process, and you need to know very technical specifications in order to pull a contract together, then by all means, if you have five questions that are like, are we looking at 15 millimeter or 17 millimeter? Like, I got to get this right in the proposal.
Yeah, right.
Because it is fine. I have no problem with that. But if you're asking basic 5 to 7 questions over and over and over again, be the professional and memorize those questions so that you can naturally ask them. I mean, even in my 6-question framework, my Aligning Brilliance tool, I know those 6 questions. Now, I'll tell you, Alan, when I first started using it in the 90s, I just wrote down the words, not all the questions, but I would have a piece of paper or a pad in front of me, and I would write down strengths, what's working, objectives, benefits, concerns, tweaks. And those would just remind me, but I wasn't going in and like scrolling. I was going in to actively listen. And I think there's a big difference.
And I think you're so right, because I don't have a problem with having a pad and taking notes, because it does show the customer that you are listening. But here, I'm going to give you what happened that I experienced. This was last week, and it was this happened on Zoom, which made it even more effective. So I introduced these two guys. One guy owned a company, and the other guy was the head of a marketing company. Two great guys. And as soon as I met the both of them, I'm like, I got to hook these guys together. So I got on a Zoom with the two of them, and I let them talk. So the marketing guy would ask a question, and then the guy who owned the company would answer. And you could tell he was writing down, but he wasn't like not paying attention, but he would ask very, very good questions. And then at the end of it, he took his pad and he held up like this. He held his pad up and he said, I just want to let you know that this is what I heard, what you just told me. And he had, these are all the 10 things that are important to you. These are the issues you're having. These are the solution. These are the, and he had it like in quadrants. As soon as he did that, the sale was done. I was blown away and I wasn't buying anything. And the guy who was like, he felt so listened to. And again, it was taking notes, but it wasn't like in a survey format. It was just, him asking the right questions and writing down, but then showing the customer, make sure, did I get all this right? These are the questions that are important to you, that blah, blah, blah. I thought it was absolutely brilliant. It was really well done.
It is brilliant. And I think that one of the things that we need to do more of in sales, exactly as this guy just did, is to validate what it is that we think that we are hearing. And so to really kind of clarify that back.
Yes.
So it's like, so an example would be, so Alan, what I hear you saying is taking notes by a quadrant of a client's issues is actually really effective. Did I hear that correctly? Did I get it right? And that blows your prospect's mind that you're willing to not regurgitate word for word, not condescending, but to really paraphrase, am I getting all your issues? Am yes. I understanding you?
Awesome. We are definitely on the same page, that's for sure. All right, let's see. One more question, and then we're going to get to the question of the week, the Ask Alan segment of the podcast. I think I'm having too much whiskey. I got to slow down. So,
it's all good. Okay. This is fun.
Yeah, this is good. So, and you may have answered this, but I wrote the question down anyway. So, I've heard you say that price is never the real sale amount. You know, what do you mean by that? That price is never the real sale amount?
Yeah. So, one of the things that I really believe is that if you are trying to sell something for X, and somebody comes in with a budget that's a little bit below X, you're no longer, the price is no longer X. It's just the gap. So in a real world, if I'm selling a house, and let's just say you walk in and your budget, just for easy math, it's 500,000, and the sale of the house is 650, then the real sale amount is the 150. That's what our conversation needs to explore, is that 150 differential. It's no difference if somebody wants to pay $7 for a widget, you're selling it for $9, it's a $2 price amount. It's the gap that is the real price that you're talking about, because they came in prepared to spend a certain amount of money. And so one of the things that I hear, like when I used to shadow sales teams for years, you'd have them keep talking about the higher price. Oh, it's worth $650, it's worth $650, or it's worth $9. And I'd be like, stop talking about the biggest number and start talking about why it's worth the $250. Why it's worth the $2 more. Because first of all, it's much more approachable in the mind, the brain of your customer. And that's also the real sale amount. That's what you're trying to convince them to step up into the value of that gap.
Wow, that's really good. I've never heard that before. That's brilliant. A lot of brilliant stuff tonight. I really like that. Because you're right.
Well, it works.
Yeah, because there is always an expectation of price, and it's usually lower than what the price actually is almost 100% of the time. But you're right. People... to focus on the difference rather than just the amount that it costs is psychologically, that's a really good move. I like that.
Well, a real example is when we do our online programs, we're doing them for the whole company. So when we changed the training industry, everybody was like, oh, Alan, if you hire us, it's X. But then if you want to share it with anybody, you know, it's X plus 10, right?
Right.
And so we flipped that model and we said, no, it's just X, right? But then we would occasionally get pushback on just X being high. And I'd say, well, what were you planning on spending? And they'd be like, you know, X minus two. And instead of continuing to use the X, I would always just do the gap. And it was amazing how quickly you could get them to realize that just a little bit more and all the value behind it wasn't that big of a decision. You're just changing the framing and the psychology in the conversation. And it's not manipulative. Yeah. If you no. really believe in the value of what you're offering.
Of course. And it's never like a lot of my book is based on, like you said, how the brain works and how we live as humans and as a tribe and everything. And, you know, some people say, well, that sounds like you're being manipulative. I'm like, no, I'm not. I'm trying to use how the brain works so the customer feels more comfortable purchasing what you're selling. That's what you ultimately want to do, is they have to be comfortable with what you're doing. And there's ways the brain thinks to make them feel comfortable. You just have to it's like when you set up your pricing in threes, the customer's going to feel more comfortable if you set it up properly, even if it's the higher amount. It's psychological, but that's how you have to do it.
So works. It's so true. You are spot on, Alan.
Well, if I was in San Diego, we would be meeting for a glass of wine to geek out on sales talk more, but we're running out of time, but I'm going to get to the Ask Alan section. And this is right up our alley, especially with what we've just been talking about. So a great segue. So this comes from, actually, she's over in your neck of the woods. She's in Seattle, Washington. You're in San Diego, right? So this is Hillary W. from Seattle writes, Dear Alan, I always struggle when it comes to presenting the price. The customer always has to think about it and usually says it's too high. I don't know what I'm doing wrong. Help. What would we say to Hillary over in Seattle?
Well, the first thing that I would say, Hillary, is you're not doing anything wrong. You're normal. You're superhuman. And one of the things that I would question for you is, are you really doing all the due diligence ahead of time? So I would probably take a two-pronged approach to this. One, am I doing the prep work ahead of time to really understand the cost of not moving forward? So before I talk about price, am I setting a case for value and the cost of not doing business with me, right? And really working through that psychologically so that I've got my numbers in order, I can present a really good case. The second is, and I'm going to say this because it sounds a little goofy, but I mean it sincerely, do you practice delivering price before the meeting even starts? Do you get to the point where you can say it without blushing, without stumbling, that you can say it clearly and confidently and with conviction and without like apologizing for the price? Like, do you practice? Because that's something that you have to get comfortable with in yourself first to be like, Alan, this costs $10,000. Alan, this is $10,000. Alan, this is $10,000. And you say it enough that when Alan's like, oh my God, that's too high, you can look that person right in the eye and say, oh, interesting. Okay, well, tell me more about that. What's the thought behind too high? And you don't blink.
Yes. And you, like you said, it's conviction. It's like, if you don't believe in your price, then you need to find another job or find another product, because you have to believe what you sell is worth what you're charging for it. And that's where it starts. And you're right. The reps that have the conviction, there's a rep out there that I used to ride along with when I would do some consulting. And he would say, he would give the price and he would go, that's a deal. Now, he was a little over the top, but he would always say, that's a deal. No matter what the price was, that's a deal. And other reps were like scared to give the price. Like, oh my God, I think that's too much. I can't show this. So you're right. You got to be convinced about it. So that's great advice. I'm going to answer this in a psychological way. So what I would tell Hillary is, I love pricing. It's one of my favorite things to look at and study and talk about. And one of the things is, there's a lot of pricing techniques that work psychologically for the customer to feel comfortable or to actually be prepared for the price. And one of them is called anchoring. And what I would do is, I like to always ask the question at some point, when you're comfortable and you kind of go through the needs and the questions we've been talking about. Do you think, let's say she sells widgets. Do you think, Mr. Smith, a widget is going to be more than $10 or less than $10? Now, the widget is only $5, but the $10 is now anchored in the person's mind. And he would say, well, I hope it's less than 10. And then you go on with the rest of your value and all that stuff. But the 10 is now sitting in the back of his head. So when the widget shows up to be $5 or $7.50, psychologically, he thinks it's a good price because you anchored this higher number in his head. And that's not unethical. It's just a way of getting them to a point where they feel more comfortable with the price based on how their brain works.
So the geek in me is just like, again, this is awesome. So one of the things that I love about what you're sharing is that the brain needs a comparison point, a reference point. And that's what you're saying. It's that anchor. Yep. You've now planted that $10 seed and you come in low and it's like, oh, sigh of relief. If you plant 10 and then you turn out to be 12, you will never close that deal.
You're dead.
Yeah, exactly. But what I love about it is that you are anchoring. And another way to do it, if it makes you feel comfortable, is to pick another competitor with a higher price point. So I will say, you know, you can hire a celebrity speaker. You can hire them for 75 grand. I get it. They will fill seats. But you also need a speaker who will fill minds. So if you would like something that's far more budget friendly, you know, and now I've planted 75 and they're out there, trust me. Celebrities are 75, 100,000 for a speaker. So when I come in at a fraction of that and I'm filling minds, it's like, wow, we send us the contract.
That's a deal right there.
That's a deal.
That's a deal. So yeah, the anchoring works. Yeah, there's so many things you can do about pricing. It's one of my favorite things. So, well, Hillary, we hope that helped. We are already at 45 minutes, and AmyK, this went amazingly fast, and we definitely should do this again, or at least have conversations in the future, because I really appreciate you being on the podcast tonight. So Any parting thoughts for my guests? We have a lot of salespeople, a lot of marketing people. We even have a lot of business people. I get notes from saying, great podcast. It's been a lot of fun. So what would you say as some closing remarks?
I'll do one more magical phrase. So first of all, thank you, because my brain's buzzing. Alan, I love talking to super smart, energetic people, and I'm not blowing smoke. I'll close with one of my all-time favorite magical phrases for walking into any conversation that you are leading. Start with the really super small but mighty words, how might we, and then fill in the blank. So how might we solve this problem? How might we create a partnership? How might we move you forward? How might, whatever it is that you're there to talk about, how might we question frames it that we're going to create space for possibility and that your voice matters too. We're going to co-create the future together.
How might we? I like that. Instead of just saying, how can I help you? How might we is a little more powerful. I like that.
Well, it was like you and I before the podcast, you know, how might we make sure that we have a conversation that rocks and rolls? That's something that just allows us to both jump in and both feel significant.
Yes. And it creates the partnership you were talking about at the beginning. Because selling is a partnership. It has to be a partnership. It can't be the person can't feel like he was sold to or she was sold to. If it's got to feel
no
like
cheesy.
Collaboration.
No cheesy allowed.
Time out. AmyK, thank you very much for joining me. Everyone, this has been Marketing and Sales Over Cocktails, episode 21. This was AmyK and Alan Langer. And I'd like to thank Hillary for her question. Once again, send your question to Ask Alan at marketingandsalespodcast.com. And again, if I read your question on the air, you will get a free signed autographed copy of my book. And check out Amy's book. It's called Get It. It just came out in May, so I'm sure you can find it on Amazon and wherever you find books. It is literally the next thing I'm doing after I hit the stop button on the play recording here. Thanks, everyone, for joining, and we'll see you again next time.